As many of you might know if you've seen my previous videos, and especially the Konosuba video where I talk about the realities of actually adventuring, you know that my favorite genre in anime, and anything really, is adventure. So Shingeki no Bahamut, a fantasy anime focused on adventuring in a world full of gods, demons, dragons, and humans, is basically right up my alley. Recently, I've binged through the first season of Genesis, and I'm currently caught up on the second season of Virgin Soul. What strikes me the most about this franchise is the contrast between the two series, and how they handle the scale and sense of their respective adventures. You see, Genesis follows a bounty hunter escorting a demon girl toward a place known as Helheim, with a disgraced nobleman and a zombie girl chasing after them, along with the whole cadre of gods and demons. Along the way, the series shows us a variety of environments as they trudge through forests, ruined towns, massive cities, and even no man's land of floating rocks surrounding the terrible form of Bahamut, the draconic threat the show's title derives from. Few of the 12 episodes take place in the same location, and the scale of adventure gets across the idea that this world is a very large, multifaceted place. Distance is covered in leaps and bounds between episodes, which has its own benefits and liabilities, since it allows us to focus on the important things that happen in each location, but it also has the side effect of losing the interconnectedness of the world between these stages. Each place feels almost like its own little world, and while this is probably intentional in the differences between heaven, hell, and the mortal plane, in many ways, Genesis feels like a video game rushing toward a conclusion without really stopping to smell the roses, all but a scant few times. Having only 12 episodes no doubt contributes to this, especially compared to the double-length second season currently airing, and it is one of the biggest criticisms I do have with the show, as much as I do love it. However, just the fact that it does show us that other places exist in this world improves the sense that there's world out there to explore in future series. In that regard, a lot of Genesis feels like the setup to these future series I'm talking about, and I think the fact that Virgin Soul instead chooses to focus on one location, almost at the expense of all the others, is an extremely intriguing choice. Not only is this a daring choice when there's still so much to see in the wider world, but sticking to one place for most of a series can have severe drawbacks, as Dragon Age 2 can certainly attest. For those that don't know, Dragon Age 2 is a video game set almost entirely in the city of Kirkwall, whereas Virgin Soul manages to make its setting city of Anatea feel alive and gigantic, especially compared to how the same city felt in Genesis, DA2 suffers heavily from only really existing in one place. While there are differences between the more passive medium of watching an anime versus the much more active role of playing a video game, especially in the time spent with each product, I do think Virgin Soul could have easily fallen prey to the same pratfalls of samey hallways and small areas of actual traversal, along with boring samey enemies. And to an extent, the show certainly does suffer from these concepts a little bit. The Onyx Guard, for example, are the main antagonist of Virgin Soul, each clad in onyx armor, of course, with a green gem in the chest plates, always wearing helmets, so there's not really any way to differentiate one from the other. Except for the captain, of course, the one with the black face paint. He's kind of creepy. This is contrasted even more with the previous series' enemies, since the antagonists were demons, who could range from gigantic behemoths to lithe fallen angels like Azazel. So comparatively, the Onyx Guard will obviously fall short, just like the endless waves of bandits in Kanari of Dragon Age 2. Unlike Dragon Age 2, what Virgin Soul does right is make the alleyways and general city interesting whenever the characters are walking through it. One day there might be a parade, while another day the characters might be running a food stand. Or maybe Nina is just out walking through a festival of lights and food with a mysterious guy. Even the demons ducking from one alley to another, or sometimes even flying between them, is different from Nina's broad, excited steps through the streets. Not only that, but the locations in the city are nice and varied. From a giant coliseum in the south of the city, to a demon ghetto to the west, built into a winding pit that might have once been a mine or maybe even a new crater from Bahamut's rage previously. The king's palace is tall and situated at the top of the slope the city rests on, similar to the Viscount's in Dragon Age 2, But the scale of the city is so much larger than DA2's, which again comes down to the level of effort in just drawing a city in a few environments, as opposed to creating a whole 3D rendition of a city for a video game. It's just that all of this together just reinforces my opinion that Virgin Soul's city and overall atmosphere and story is similar to what Dragon Age 2 wanted to give the player, but couldn't because of time and effort invested in the game. Whether or not DA2 could have given a similar experience to watching Virgin Soul is impossible for me to say truly, and a topic for another video, but I want you guys to recognize that I do know the incredible amount of effort it would take to imitate Virgin Soul's, to me, better sense of scale, less still environments and enemies, in a video game you spend 10 times the amount of time in. I just thought it was interesting that Virgin Soul seems to feel exactly what DA2 wanted to be. On a similar, but completely opposite note, Genesis feels a lot like it wanted to be what Dragon Age Origins turned out to be. Unfortunately, like I said earlier, only being given 12 episodes severely limited its options, but the story of Genesis felt a lot like my experiences playing Origins. Each location offered a little bit of insight into what was going on in the area, politically or culturally, with a few allies picked up along the way. And the travel between two places was generally just done off-screen or through loading screens with the case of Origin. But while Origins had the benefit of a much longer playtime and the ability to allow the player to choose what to do and who to talk to, Genesis had to get across a rather dense story and complete it as soon as possible. It's just beat after beat after beat, but there were glimpses of its wish to just slow down and further investigate even the smaller things going on around them, like in Anatea or the village where Kaiser picked up Rita. These small moments of character building, as the relationships, platonic or otherwise, between Kaiser and Rita or Jean and Favreau are furthered through conversations, remind me a lot of what talking to my companions around the campfire between story areas and Origins felt like. Not only do these conversations strengthen these characters by giving us more glimpses of themselves, but it also lets us see how they view the world around them, further revealing how people in this world interact with their respective environments. Favreau views his lot in life as an ever-blowing wind, sweeping him from place to place, both free and locked in a single direction, a cognitive dissonance that he has to come to terms with in his own flamboyantly jubilant way. Kaiser sees only the confines of a station, yet comes to learn there's more breathing room than he gives his life credit for. Jean has gained aspirations of being a hero over her long journey, even though she was compelled at the start to be so by the gods. And Rita wants to change from the constant drudgery of an immortal life, so she takes a chance with the mortals she finds herself accompanying. All of these motivations give us a sense of the world, how their opinions and philosophies are shaped by the world, and shape it in turn, as well as the kinds of cultures they grew up in, work in, and continue forward through. Much more of this type of personality-driven world-building is shown in Virgin Soul, with Nina, Muguro, Bacchus, Azazel, and all the old characters all bouncing off one another. Perhaps this is why Nina's tale works so well. The world we've seen in the first series is out there waiting, but how these new and old characters have changed as a result of how much time has passed offers more and more insights into the world we didn't get to see as much this time. A lesson I believe Dragon Age 2 could have taken to heart by having the setting not be so far removed from the events of Origins. Virgin Soul does in its sequel what I've always thought a movie, series, or any kind of adaptation should do when playing in an already created world. Use what's already there, but tell a different facet of the world if the previous story is already complete, rather than just replaying the same story we know already, or taking it so far away from what we loved in the first place that it loses the benefit of the world building that existed prior. Regardless, despite the more limited setting of Virgin Soul, I almost feel like it explores the world more than Genesis, despite not physically doing so. It uses what we know and builds on it further, and I can only imagine whatever series comes after will do much the same. These two shows have their own scales of adventure, but together, they create something larger than they could have on their own. Perfectly complementary media working in tandem, even if they still have their own individual faults. I'm actually also pretty curious to know if any of you viewers watched Virgin Soul before Genesis, and what your experience of the world was. Anyway, if you enjoyed my thoughts on the show, you can find many, many more videos from me on all types of show I've had a blast watching. So subscribe for more of those and hit that notification button to make sure you don't miss a single one. And if you have a friend you think might like my content, give it a share. If you ever feel like sharing your own thoughts on the show or how I talk about anime in my videos, just leave a comment down below. Or you can always hit me up on Twitter to rant and compliment me as your heart desires. And as always, whatever I say, however we disagree, remember, always enjoy the way you watch anime. Because as long as you're having fun, that's all that really matters. I'll see you next time.